Hi everyone, tonight's video is on membranes, both their structure and their function for the cell. So why are cells and most organelles surrounded by phospholipid membranes? If we look at this diagram of the cell with all of the organelles, you will know that most of these organelles are surrounded by phospholipid bilayers, phospholipid membranes. If you look at the nucleus, it actually has a double layer of membranes. The Golgi apparatus is made entirely of membranes. Vacuoles are surrounded by membranes, and mitochondria also have two layers of membranes. There are very few organelles that do not have membranes. In particular, the ribosomes do not have membranes, and components of the cytoskeleton, such as intermediate filaments and microtubules, do not have membranes. But almost everything else has a membrane. The function of these membranes is it allows cells to separate and compartmentalize functions and activities, allows for specialized regions of the cell in terms of function. So what are some of the properties of membranes? Membranes are selectively permeable. This is really important. Some things can pass freely through a membrane, some things can only pass through with assistance, and some things can't pass through a membrane at all. I have several videos on my YouTube channel on membrane permeability that will cover this in far more detail. Membranes are also very fluid. They're much more like a baggie than a box. So what are membranes composed of? Well, membranes are composed of a phospholipid bilayer with embedded proteins. Animal cell membranes also have cholesterol, and I'll talk more about the function of this later in this video. Let's look at our lipids first. Our phospholipids have a polar head group composed of glycerol and phosphate, and then they also have fatty acid tails. The tails I've drawn here are saturated fatty acids, and you know this because I've drawn them in a straight line. Saturated fatty acids are produced by animals, and they pack very tightly together due to their straight structure. So if we looked at a phospholipid bilayer from an animal cell, we would see these phospholipids with our straight or saturated fatty acids packed very tightly together. So how do animal membranes maintain membrane fluidity if their phospholipids are packed very tightly together? Wouldn't that make them more like a box than a baggie? When I said that membranes are much more like a baggie than a box. Well, they use a lipid called cholesterol to help maintain membrane fluidity. Cholesterol is a steroid. It has the classic four-ring structure of a steroid, and it is a lipid. So where we see cholesterol is intercalated in the membrane in between these fatty acid tails. Cholesterol structure prevents the tight packing of these lipids because it's kind of big and bulky. And what it does is it gives space between these fatty acid tails so that they don't pack too tightly together. Especially in cold temperatures where you tend to see less kinetic energy and less movement, cholesterol helps maintain membrane fluidity in these animal membranes that have these saturated or straight fatty acids, and it doesn't allow them to pack so tightly together that the membrane becomes solid. The membrane never becomes solid. It maintains its fluidity even at these low temperatures because of the elbow room that cholesterol gives. Cholesterol actually helps at the other end of the temperature spectrum too, at high temperatures. You don't want your membrane to be so fluid that at high temperatures, the motion goes so crazy that your membrane actually falls apart. You don't want it to be leaky. And cholesterol helps animal membranes maintain integrity by kind of keeping those tails together in warm temperatures. What about phospholipids and membranes with unsaturated fatty acids? So we would still have a polar head group composed of glycerol and phosphate and two unsaturated fatty acids, which are again indicated by this bent shape. Remember, in nature, unsaturated fatty acids tend to be made in the cis format, which is bent. And because of that, these do not pack tightly together, just due to that kinked nature. These cis unsaturated fatty acids are made by plants and by fish. So with plants and fish, you don't need cholesterol in their membranes because they can adjust the ratio of saturated to unsaturated fatty acids to keep the fluidity constant at varying temperatures. Let's look at this membrane diagram here. It has a mix of saturated and unsaturated fatty acid. If a fish or a plant was in a very cold environment, you would perhaps see a larger ratio of unsaturated fatty acid, giving it more room and more ability to stay fluid in these cold temperatures, whereas in a warm temperature, you might see a higher ratio of saturated or straight fatty acids that can pack more tightly together in order to maintain that membrane fluidity. Because plants and fish can adjust their ratios, they do not need to use cholesterol to maintain their membrane fluidity and integrity. What are some of the functions of our membrane proteins? Well, first, I want to talk about some of the locations where these proteins can be. Membrane proteins can either be peripheral, so on the outside edge of the protein, or on the, outside edge of the membrane, or on the inside edge of the membrane. Or they can be transmembrane. They can cross the entire span, the entire phospholipid bilayer, and be present on both ends and in the middle. Some of the functions of our membrane proteins, well, they could be transport proteins. A transmembrane protein might be a transport protein because this could transport substances all the way through the membrane in this transmembrane channel. We could also have enzymes as membrane proteins. Enzymes tend to be peripheral proteins on the outside or inside edge of the membrane. We could also have a membrane protein that's a receptor. Those are going to either be transmembrane or peripheral, but what you do know is it will be exposed on the outside edge of the cell. It turns out that cells within a body talk to each other. They send messages. They send messages in the form of chemical messages. And if you're going to send a message, it's important that the cell sends to a cell that can hear it. In order to hear the message, you need a receptor, something to receive that message. So some peripheral proteins and some transmembrane proteins are receptors to receive information from other cells. You can also have membrane proteins whose job it is to attach to structures both inside and outside of the cell. A specific example is a transmembrane protein called an integrin. It's pictured here in blue. Integrins span the entire membrane. They attach to cytoskeletal fibers inside the cell, and they also attach to this fibrous network outside the cell called the extracellular matrix. Our cells in our body are not just floating around. They are fixed and attached in their location, and integrins are what aid cells in doing this by keeping both the inside and the outside of the cell attached and fixed in one location. So you should know that membranes are selectively permeable. You should know that membranes are fluid and not static. You should know the different ways that animal versus plant and fish membranes maintain their fluidity and integrity. You should know that membranes are composed of phospholipid bilayer with embedded proteins and cholesterol for animal cells. And you should know the function of lipids, cholesterol, and proteins in membranes. So that's all for tonight.